Edinburgh, international city, capital of Scotland, seat of political power. In the 21st century, we have the trappings of nationhood. On Prince's Street, you hear voices from 100 different countries. But what language do we speak? In a world where regional differences are breaking down, do we in Scotland simply use English with an accent, or is there something more distinctive about our mother tongue? We have Gaelic, of course, but in this programme, I'm interested in how the rest of us speak, so I'm taken to the road to find out if there's still such a thing as the Scots language. However far we travel from home, we meet the same goods and services, the same global brands. The international market is blamed for robbing communities of their individuality. And on this journey through Scotland, I want to find out if the same thing is happening to our language. Is the globalization of language destroying the unique way we speak and in the process eroding our identity? Ironically, the long history of pressure from outside our borders actually helped to define us as a nation, especially in the long struggle with England. It's always intrigued me how the closer you get to a frontier, the more national differences and characteristics are accentuated. And here in the Scottish borders, it's no exception. Because they're so close to England, local traditions and language are a proud badge of identity. Driving through Hawick, I stopped to pick up two guys who are on their way to Selkirk to take part in the common ridings, one of the defining traditions of border life.
Hello. To Selkirk.
How does?
Perfect.
Together, David Chapman and Ian Scott are better known as the folk group Scotia. I want to know how important dialect is to local traditions.
The thing that's great about the language is the about the border language, the border tongue. So much of the border language isn't it written down, right? So that very fact and means that it's been passed down from generation to generation. So it's a great unique link to your past and to your heritage and to your history.
There's great words. They're very, very descriptive. And instead of being wet in Hawick or the borders, you're drookit wet. You're plaching, which means you're not just damp, you're absolutely bloody ringing.
One of my favourites is to use the word muckle. If you say something's big, then it's big. If you say something's big and huge, that's like really big. If you say something's muckle big, it's really big. But if you say something's muckle big huge, then that's like, that's just enormous. There's nothing bigger than muckle big huge.
The not very muckle town of Selkirk lies at the heart of countryside, which was disputed territory for hundreds of years. Back then, defending a town's boundaries against enemies asserted the right of border folk to exist. This warlike past has been honoured for generations with an annual event known as Common Riding. This is a big day, the day of the riding. As you can see, the place is heaving with folk, keen to see them safe out and safe in. It's an event that's become a bedrock of border tradition. Are you from Selkirk?
I am, yes. Yeah.
How important is today for you?
Very important. I've ridden it since I think I was about 8 or 9 years old, so I've been here obviously all my life and brought up with it with my family as well, so yeah, very important to us.
Are there any words or phrases that you might have that you would maybe associate with Selkirk?
Well, definitely safe out, safe in for the riders, you know, like heading from here, like over the hills, just to make sure they get a way out okay and then back safely.
The borders have been borders since at least Roman times. The Common Riding reenacts this history, dramatising the importance of keeping hold of what's been fought over for centuries. As nearly 450 riders leave the town, I meet up with writer and historian Walter Elliott.
In the borders, you get lots of different languages that have come in at various times. First, when the Romans left, well, they spoke Welsh. The Anglians came in, this is a Germanic language, and this Germanic language sort of moved up the province of Angeln in northern Germany. And they produced the language which we now think of as Scots, but was then is also the basis of English.
Walter tells me that many place names in the borders, like Selkirk itself, which means a kirk in the forest, are a reminder of the Germanic tribes that settled here 1,500 years ago. But although the Anglo-Saxon spoken by these people is the ancestor of English and Scots, both languages developed separately, so it's as absurd to say that Scots is a dialect of English as it is to say English is a dialect of Scots. It seems to me that Borders history says a lot about the way folk speak in these parts. The debatable lands were the haunt of outlaws, reavers and rebels, and the Scots spoken here became a kind of verbal resistance movement.
Tiribus!
Tiribus, Tiribusi Tiriodin was the war cry at the Hike Boys when they were going into battle. And it's also where, if you come for a hike and you're a Tiri, that's where it comes from, Tiribus. In Hike, we've got a really distinct, broad accent. You go to a town even 5 miles up the road, and it's a completely different language, really. It might sound similar to, for somebody outside Hike, but we can tell, we can tell. It's keeping the youngins here. Keeping the youngins here to keep the dialect going, that's a problem. And the youngins are in the stain, that's a problem.
Everybody's using universal words that they're picking up on the movies. And
because of the media.
You're not doing TV, though.
Unfortunately, you didn't really get dialects, so that's the thing, though. You never get dialects. It's accents you get, aye. I mean, the Proclaimers are a typical example of that. Everybody assumes that the Proclaimers are singing in Scots, but they're not singing in Scots at all. They sing with an accent, but they didn't sing in dialect.
When I wake up, I can, I'm gonna be the man that wakes up next to you. And when I'm gonna, I can, I'm gonna be the man that goes along with you. If I get drunk, I can, I'm gonna be the man that gets drunk next to you. And when I heave up, I can, I'm gonna be the man that's heaving into you. And I would walk 500 miles, and I would walk 500 miles.
We've got a rain forum on the Scotia website, so it's great because it's a great way of not just Scotia fans but Hike folk for the hour of the world keeping in touch. One of the rules on the forums is that you have to speak in Hike or type in Hike, which is much easier than doing English because English, I can't spell English, so. And you can just type it on your way at Soons in Hike, which is great. So it just gives you an example of what we've got in here. We leave the morn's afternoon. I canna wait. Hope the sun keeps on shining for us when we're hame. Sighs our sin, man, I'm fair excited. That's great.
When I die, pray me Lord, where I can hear the pointing voice.
The language of the border seems in fine fettle, with fabulous words like Tiri, Plashin and Drukit still in current use. But in recent years, the closure of woolen mills and the decline in farming has wrecked the economy and threatens this wonderful dialect as youngsters move to the cities looking for work. Leaving the rolling hills of the borders, I'm heading north to a city by the sea to find out how Scots is faring in a traditional urban environment.
This is the word on the page.
Well, my name is St. Andrew, and I'm here to tell you what the story was then and what the story is new. A fun
myself, better side of a law, we a battle.
What is that song?
I looked around and I thought, oh,
it's rare to be alive. is it?
I'm heading for Dundee, city of jute, jam and crivens, jigs and help my bob. Those enduring and lovable cartoon characters, the Bruins and Oor Willie, hail from Dundee's most famous publishing house, DC Thompson Newspapers. But how Dundonian or even Scottish are they? To find out, I've come to meet the author of this book, Dundonian for Beginners.
There was really a backlash against kind of this Dundonese thing that was getting put out from DC Thompson's. There wasn't any real Dundonian stuff happening. The nearest you got was the Bruins and Oor Willie. I mean, although that stuff was funny, it just wasn't real. It wasn't real Dundonian stuff. On the one hand, you've got that as the fantasy, ha ha ha, but on the other hand, you've got this kind of patronising thing that's ignoring the reality. But that's one of the reasons I've done that. I kind of brought real Dundonian up front rather than it being hidden.
One of my favourite bits in here is the spot the difference, the Dundee phrases. Could you explain to me the difference between no affy weel and affy no?
Anytime you say that to somebody, no affy weel, they'll always question you back. Now, do you share that? You know what I mean? Affy no weel or just no affy weel? Just to kind of make the difference between the two. But one's just a wee kind of no feeling quite with it, wee hangover, and the other end is really severe stuff.
What's the music we're listening to?
That's St Andrew. Uh-huh. He's a great guy. You want to speak to St Andrew. It's quite hard to pin down, though. He's a real recluse. He's
pin down as a Dundee accent?
Very. Actually, worse, probably, because he's the one that entertains everybody with it, but there's his phone number.
Well, your secret's...
Didn't tell him it was me.
Well, your secret's safe with me. Don't worry about that.
He's a recluse,
right.
After all.
OK. Mick, thank you
very
much.
Good to see you, Carl.
Good. Thanks a lot.
Ciao.
Leaving a message with St Andrew, I find some real words on the pavey. The Dundee tradition of playing with language is long and honourable. Today, her most famous son is still the unlikely poet and tragedian, William McGonagall, whose mangled verse aped Victorian epic poetry, but is now part of the fabric of the city. Beautiful railway bridge of the Silvery Tay that has caused the Emperor of Brazil to leave his home far away, incognito in his dress, and view thee ere he passed along en route to Inverness. Tragic stuff, but the man who mangled the English language was typically Dundonian of Irish descent and working class. Back in the 19th century, Dundee was a boomtown and cultural melting pot. Men and women flocked here from all over Scotland, but especially from Ireland. Like William McGonagall's family, they came to work in the factories and mills or on the waterfront where ships and whalers filled the docks. Dundonian poet Ellie MacDonald loves the language that developed on the shores of the Tay. The Dundee accent is unique. What do you think causes this? What's the background to this?
Well, wonderful. It's distinctive and only Dundee. If you also listen and remember that the biggest majority are Dundonians, if you scratch the surface, you get Irish.
What changes have you noticed in the accent or in the way that it's used?
If you're with Dundonians, you're going to speak with your own dialect. But you find yourself in Naffy lot at the time, hain't to talk, can know your Dundee accent, but more like what would crash Scots English. Everybody has to have 12 voices. I think this is a kind of being bilingual. I don't see anything wrong with it. I'm proud of my Dundee accent. Everybody is that speaks it. But you didn't go into your doctor and say, see me, I've got a Naffy saved but in the least of my leg and ken me what's killing us. You didn't do that. So that. You switch yourself around, as everybody does, and quite right. I mean, there are 12 languages. Why should you know hate 12 languages? You have your language for your friends and your family, and you have your language that you hate to use.
How about the influences from maybe outside globalisation, the internet, that sort of thing? Do you feel that that is a threat to the local accent?
The percentage of Dundonians who now speak with a good Dundee accent has probably diminished. But I'm an optimist, Carl. I'm an absolute optimist. This dialect's been going on for 200 years. It's not going to be beaten.
by a mere flip of a switch on an internet, I hope. Because what else are we? We're here and we're Dundonians and we'll be Dundonians till the pit's in the sun.
Our East Coast gibber's quite unique. It's got the rest of Scotland utterly seek and jealous that they can't speak the Dundee speak. Egg, he's a plenty, a bridie and an ingany and an ah. And other gems like Tolly, Flegg, Cundy, Gochel. Oh, the language is bra. So we're here to promote it, no try and talk polite. This oh yes I can business, that just isn't it right. With our 800 years of historical blether, so dinna strangle it, let it rip. Speak the Queen's English? Never.
Keeping the language alive are three guys whose tongue-lashing performances delight Dundonians wherever they gather together.
We grew up no speaking English. We grew up speaking the way your mums and dads and that did. But you're dealt with people speak proper. But this is proper to us. This is the way we speak.
Do you think in 50 years' time people will still be speaking the way that you do?
Well, I would like to think so. And I would like to think that people would look back at that and say, hey, that's a great way of talking. Where is that went? So we'd like to keep it going, keep it flowing as well. Like.
There's a big influence coming in over the last 5-10 years for America, and that's worldwide. And personally, I don't want to see that.
Are you guarding against Americanisms?
Oh, definitely.
It's about being yourself, is it? It's about being yourself and having confidence to be you. And that's how it is. Instead of following on the American juggernaut.
We could actually do it in our own tongue, our own voice and that as well, like, and it travels well.
There are some that say it's a wee bit raw. I don't think so at all. I think it's bra. It's fine and dandy. It's loose and free when I talk in broad Dundee. It's just as my father I spoke to me. Bear was wee. It's my mother tongue, it's a way of life. I think the talk worse hour than fife. The acha the couldn't talk like chuchters. The other half, there are poofters.
I think what we've found with doing the performance poetry in the pubs is people are happy to hear you speaking the way they do and actually getting up there and then rhyming verse in Ori Dundonian tongue. And people are like, that's great, because nobody's really doing it in a sort of poetry form. It's good to be up there, throwing it out and getting good feedback.
And let's not forget Brother Mark, leading the people out the dark, done his best, belting out rhyme and verse, fair within his heart with loads of zest, as we're progress and presses we're sell. As my reflection of why I was staring back at me, the people of Mid-Craigie. Yeah.
Inspired by the poets, I call another wordsmith.
Hello. St. Andrew. Wonderful. Great. I'll be there.
I'm in luck. The elusive rapper has granted me an exclusive interview.
What's it all about?
It's about, obviously, our love of Dundee and the Dundonian thing and all that. Yeah, sure. It's about a lot of things. Ultimately and primarily, it's about fun.
Is the voice you use a local one?
The voice that the St. Andrew character voice, it's a strange one. Years ago, when the St. Andrew thing started, we had to invent this character. And really what happened was that St. Andrew, the character of St. Andrew, was like a Dundee guy that allegedly went to America and came back for America. Can we this affy, weird, kind of half-Scottish, half-American accent? You can? This is the word on the pavement. Oh, well, my name is St. Andrew, and I'm here to tell you what the story was then and what the story is new. I fun myself, by the side of a lock, with a vat of beets and a flask of hock. I looked around and I thought, oh, it's rare to be alive, is it? It is. Michty. If anybody's supposed to ask where is the soul in St. Andrew, where is the music, the soul, where did it emanate from? The buried reels of Angus. Yeah, that's what. I'm a big fan of picking berries, so I'll try and have my annual holiday in Blair. Yeah. I quite like to get back to the soil and nabble. Nabble it.
Dundee's dialect developed from a history of immigration, and if it's rare to be alive in the city, it must have something to do with this cultural heritage, where the word on the pavey could be Tolly, Ori, or Aninganinina.
You may gang for
and fair war. All my life I've been told the northeast of Scotland has got one of the strongest regional dialects in the country. It sounds a bit strange to my ears, but I dare say that as a Soother, I sound funny to them. And you can't get more northeast than Peterhead, the blue toon, in the land where how are you is fit like, boys are loons and girls are quines. The harbour here is the last bastion of Scotland's deep-sea fishing fleet and a place where the Doric voice is traditionally very strong. But the town is under siege because the fishing is dying out. So how's the language holding up to outside forces beyond its control? James Stephen is a trawlerman, and language is closely bound to his working life.
This fish here in this box, the black one,
yeah,
we call it a podley. Now, it's a distinct name to our area.
Uh-huh.
Proper name is seith.
Uh-huh.
Some people will call it black.
Yeah.
Shetland people call them peltics. So different names from different areas.
Yeah, yeah.
150 to pair, to fight. 150 to pair. I need 375 pound. 75,
I've got.
75. I speak my own language, or my own Doric, when I'm in company with my own friends and people from this area. But business-wise, it's becoming a bit of a drawback. Before, we only dealt mostly with Scottish fishermen. Now we see Faroese, Norwegian, Denmark. It's a multinational society, and you have to learn to speak English. It's actually handy sometimes when you are abroad and you're maybe in negotiations or discussions and you don't want people to know what you're saying, then you go back to your own Doric language. It's nice, it's handy.
Yeah, aye. It's good to hear that Doric still plays a role in the international market, even if it's to discuss the price of fish. Someone else who's equally proud of the language is Val Buchan.
Peterhead is a fishing community. Not so much new as it used to be. When I was little, there was boats, aren't I? But there's not so much boats now. It's a close-knit community. Abdi kens Abdi. There's nobody that doesn't ken fit your deen or fit you've done or fit you haven't got to be deen. They all ken the colour of your washing when you hang out. They ken fit you find you going outside the door, find you come back. Squishwick.
No, a Sean in Sam made that.
Aye.
And it floats. I think Abdi's been out and even the Allard Duffus brothers have been out.
Aye. We set up an action group with the kids. It was, they used to go into community centre. There was pool tables and darts and a few things that the kids could go into all there. I would never change my language for nobody. No matter if that was, there would be the Queen, the Pope of Crikey or whatever. I wouldn't worry if that was, they would just speak the same.
Oh, the verbal address. It's just like, some folk don't understand us, but we don't understand, like, Russian sometimes, and from my part, America come around, I understand them, so really, we all speak different, and we've all just got to get used to it, really.
So far you got the world to see? It's after a rough a day. It's too cold. If they didn't understand me, well, tough. That's their lookout. I care for what I'm saying, that's our mayor's.
Fishing isn't the only tradition to support the language. Agriculture is the other, forming the backbone of Doric. 18th century literati labelled the Scots language Doric after a rural dialect of ancient Greece, and the fisher folk and farmers of the northeast adopted the name as their own. To give me an idea of how the language is faring in the 21st century, I've come to meet Les Wheeler, one of its passionate defenders.
A great deal of Doric depended on agriculture. But when agriculture changed and the horses went, that technology went, a great deal of words went out of the language. And unfortunately, the pace of change today, Scots hasn't kept up at all, anywhere. We just don't meet, the computer age. Even since the motor car and the tractor, they went far too fast for language. And we just haven't replaced those words. So the language is really dying on its feet for want of someone to say, hold on.
Les is involved in a pioneering project to revive Doric among northeast schoolchildren, with classes in storytelling, poetry, song and dance.
This is a story about the boy who cried wolf, and about a lad who'd lived far away from here, and his job he was to look after the sheep. He was in a farm, as he bed.
That language has been around for thousands of years. It's carried laws, but most importantly, It carried the voice of the ordinary man and woman in this country, and that deserves to be kept and to be looked at and to have people say, this is ours. It didn't belong to the English, it didn't belong to the Germans, it didn't belong to the French, this is ours. When other countries stand up and say, we have got our language and we have got our culture, we should be able to say the same.
But keeping Doric alive is a challenge, and if it's to have a future, perhaps it needs to find ways of surviving that don't depend on rural traditions. Scott Ironside is an actor and comedian living in the Northeast. For him, Doric is very much alive.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Iron Mike! I'm your host, Scott Ironside, and I'm going to muddle some tunes for you.
So how good a vehicle is Doric for comedy?
It's great. It's really, really handy because, you know, you can use about 20 swear words in a second. You can just rattle it off at speed. It's good for ID. So I basically sit and slag the audience off or muck fun. I suppose the 21st century as it is again, and how are things changing? Everybody's into Starbucks and McDonald's and Hollywood again, and I like to bring them back to earth, but I don't. So on one side we've got nursery rhymes, and on the other side we've got Jimi Hendrix. I am the weaver, as old Bill Hicks would say. Are you ready?
You're obviously proud of the way you speak.
Very proud, very proud, because it's part of who I am, it's part of my mock-up. It's part of the ancestry. My family's spoken it for years. Again, it's part of my identity as a Scotsman. I think it's something to be proud of and something to cherish again, and use.
You talked about the ubiquity of what's around everywhere. You know, the sense of McDonald's and stuff like that. Do you think the language is under threat?
I do. Because of the certain, and again, globalisation's the right word, aren't they? But because of all these different influences into Scotland, I mean, progress is natural, it's part of life, it's part of time. You can, but I think to lose sight of where you come from is disastrous, because then you win again where you're gone. Mm-hmm. You can, it's very important to keep these things alive and real, you can, or else, again, who are you, far are you gone?
Leaving the Northeast, I'm left with the impression that the Doric is a dialect under siege. There's great pride here in the language, but without the traditional industries which have shaped and sustained it, Doric's future is uncertain. Still on the trail of spoken Scots, it's time to head north, leaving the camper behind across the sea to Orkney. The language we speak reflects the history and landscape of a place, and this is especially true of Orkney. 1,000 years ago, it was the Viking centre of Scotland, and I expect I'll find evidence of this among today's Orcadians. Where are you from?
Kirkwall.
Kirkwall,
uh-huh.
What language do you speak?
Orcadian. Or Scottish, I suppose.
How important do you think that dialect is?
I think it's really important, actually, because, you know...
It's a sense of identity, really.
Yeah, and it's what Orkney is.
I suppose Orcadians maybe think themselves being maybe bred off the north and just kind of maybe scatterbrained all the traditional sites. They're just maybe prone to think themselves being Orcadian rather than too much Scottish.
This is the only place that this accent exists. It would be an awful shame if we lost it. We need to hold on for it as long as we can.
Hello, Hollanders. It's no appeared yet. It tends to be mostly local folk that come in. Local folk is in folk that are resident in Orkney.
The classic Arcadian word that everybody the world over canes nearly is PD.
Yes.
Which must come for French.
Yes, indeed, yes.
Who did it get here?
Who did it get here?
You can.
There was a story once about a chap at the school, and he made a mistake and he got quite upset, you see. Uh-huh. And the teacher came to him and said, what's wrong? And he says, well, he says, I'm pitting what I should have pitting put. So that was just a classic example of there is no other way to express. He couldn't have think on another way of expressing themselves.
Well, a lot of folk will finish up 5 o'clock, finish work, quick pint before they go home, so... Well, it's quite a busy night. Still the St. Magnus Festival on, so I've got a couple of performances to take in. And then, because it's the longest day, we're going to play midnight golf
through in Stromness, so it's kind of a busy evening. But it should be quite good fun, I would think. We do it because we can, I suppose, really. There's not that very many places where at midsummer it's light enough outside that you can play golf still at midnight. Well, it's just coming up just 10:55. And I think we're going to have light for, well, certainly for another 3/4 hour, I would have thought. It's one of the things that I really like about Orkney. No question, it's just fantastic.
Just over 500 years ago, Orkney wasn't even Scottish. These islands belonged to Denmark, and the people here spoke a Scandinavian language called Norn. Its influence on Arcadian culture and identity remains to this day. Tracing back the sounds of Arcadian reveals this Viking past, which I hear for myself when I meet up with local historian Harvey Johnson.
One of the first things that strikes someone coming here is that the Orkney accent is very musical. Is there any reason for this?
I think it really must be a combination of a whole lot of factors. So obviously the Norse influence, you can the old Norn language that was spoken here by the Vikings. They were here between sort of 700 and up to 1400, 1500. But obviously that was a melodic language. But then there's been the influence, or the Scots influence over the last 1,000 years as well, that's kind of come gradually into Orkney.
It wasn't until 1468 that Orkney and Shetland became Scottish. The islands were given to King James IV when he married into the Danish royal family. And from then on, Orkney was ruled by the iron-fisted Stuart earls, who did everything they could to destroy the Norn language.
The earls of Orkney here were a bad bunch. And Robert Stuart, he burnt all the old Norse books in Orkney. We sort of lost a lot of the written Norn language then, but I mean that sort of accelerated the Scottification of Orkney.
It's quite interesting because what we've been finding elsewhere is that the Scots language has been fighting an action against the invasion of English, mm-hmm. whereas what you're telling me now is that it was Scots that was the invading language.
That's right, yes. We're in a situation now where even English is being leapfrogged by this kind of global culture, but you can also have an influence on life here as well.
Sailing among the Orkney Islands, evidence of globalization isn't obvious. Instead, the landscape speaks its own particular language. And to find out how, I've taken the ferry from Kirkwall north to the small island of Westray, where Sam Harkus is looking at the origins of Arcadian place names.
Sam,
there you go.
Rare day for it.
Sam, I'm here, I'm on the island of Westray. What does the name Westray mean?
Westray quite simply means Wester Oi, the western island.
And the Oi would come from the Old Norse, presumably?
Old Norse for island, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Sam's interest in the language of the island has developed into a community project to record place names on the original 1871 Ordnance Survey maps.
There's a lot of history in that and how we pronounce the words.
How far back would some of these names go?
Most of our place names here go back to the Old Norse times. Probably about 90% or more than 90% of our original place names are Norse.
Right, this must be the road up.
Sam encourages younger islanders to record these Viking names from older inhabitants.
Remigio is there as well, which is an Old Norse word. Remigio means raven's gill, and they still lay there to this day.
Are the names people are giving you different to the ones that are on the map?
Quite a lot of them are, and there's a story there, yeah. Yeah,
yeah. What is the story?
Well, I mean, when the map maker came around, he was not a native of the place, so he would write them down as they knew them or as near as they knew them. So Wa became Wall, Boo became Bull, and we lost a lot of history due to that. Yeah.
What does Wa mean?
Wa is it's Old Norse for bay. Yeah. So it's a pier in the bay.
And Boo?
Boo was the... a boo or a bay name is the sort of manor house of the area. The sort of main house of the area, usually occupied by the laird.
Sam hopes his project will preserve the old names and pronunciations for future generations. To give me a better understanding of how these place names relate to the landscape and how they've changed through time, he takes me on a field trip. So what's the name of the castle, Sam?
The castle here, if you look at the name on the gate, it's Naultland Castle, N-O-L-T, land. Now, Nault or Nout was cattle, so it's cattle land. This whole area here must have been cattle land at one time. But somebody somewhere along the line has put an L in it. We describe it as Nautland, and always have done. If you look up there, you've got a house called Iphs, I-P-H-S, and that is the eaves of a house. It just describes the sort of topography of the where the house is. And just down from that, you've got a house called Vinnabrek. Now, that is an amalgamation of two Old Norse names, which is pasture on the slope.
So place names in the landscape are not just a form of living history. They keep the sounds of the Old Norn language alive. But to go back further into Orkney's Scandinavian past, I need to do some island hopping.
I'm about to take the world's shortest scheduled air flight from Westray to Papa Westray. Timetable says it takes 2 minutes, but it's been done in 38 seconds, and I've got a date I'm anxious to keep.
The plane spends more time taxiing than in flight, but once we're airborne, I have my first glimpse of Papey, which is less than half a mile from the end of the runway. At just 4 miles long and a mile wide, the 70 folk who live on the island have an accent to die for. With the sound of the twin prop still ringing in my ears, it's a relief to feel solid ground under my feet. Setting off to walk to the other side of the island, I don't get far before I'm overtaken by events or a tractor driven by my date. At 83, Maggie Harkus has lived on Papey all her life.
My lift.
Papey talk is full of words and phrases that are unique to the island. And it's here in the kitchen, listening to Maggie and her friend Elizabeth, that I get closer to the original Scandinavian sounds.
And there's two oceans in that one.
Oh, yes, I think that's been. Oh, yes, that's two beasts and no horse. There's some job training in that oceans for they were. Kind of frightened to get them to stand alongside of the horse. You kind of go and get them to come with the horse. Mm-hmm. Do a lot of training. Mm-hmm. And then in the harvest time, I think it would first it would just been a hook, would it be?
It could have been, yes.
The size.
Settle the
cotton.
There's quite a lot of what you're saying that I'm missing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm picking up. A bit of it. I mean, enough to make sense. But I'm missing, you know.
So you were likely.
Yeah, yeah.
But we speak kind of quick. We're kind of inclined to do that. I try to speak though.
Are there words that you would use that you don't hear outside now?
There are a few just ordinary Papey Westry words, right? Mm-hmm. Yes. Like you would speak about a wither, a mugger of foo.
It's just a kind of mild day, but it's a. Drizzly way. It's got mugger of fear.
Never heard that in my life.
Never heard that one.
Yeah. And a certain type of weather is a gamfer for snow you speak about.
Well, that's right.
A gamfer for snow?
Yes, it means it's a forewarning that maybe snow's going to come.
Snow's on the way?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you have any expressions for bright days?
We don't know. Usually hear some. For bright days, I don't think which is.
We're so surprised to have that.
That's why I ask.
That's right.
It'd be so rare.
Oh, we'd say it was a grand day today.
It's still not brightened up much as I leave Papey. In fact, it even feels a bit gamfer for snow. Boarding the ferry, I think about the words I've learned from Maggie and Elizabeth. Peaty for small, dugget for stubborn, mugger of foo for clammy weather. Yet somehow the language seems vulnerable, attached to traditions that are fading into history. Crossing the sea and heading 70 miles north, I get to Shetland. At latitude 60 degrees, the islands are closer to the coast of Norway than they are to Scotland's capital city. Shetland lies next to vast oil fields which have led to dramatic social changes. Traditional ways of life are dying out, so has the language survived these outside pressures?
Very good evening, Shetland, and thanks for tuning in. Coming up, operators of the Lerwick Power Station under fire over the way they carry out their emission tests.
I'm encouraged by the sound of the man on the taxi's radio. If the BBC are broadcasting in Shetlandic, the language must be doing well. And then the sight of Norwegian yachts in the harbour is a reminder of Scandinavia's part in shaping the language when Vikings arrived here 1,000 years ago. And I want to find out how today's incomers are settling in. In Lerwick, a language initiative encourages classes in Shetlandic. I joined a lesson for non-native speakers with the teacher, Laureen Johnson, is keen to get us speaking the dialect.
What about exercise do you take, Sally?
A periska.
A periska.
I go once a week to the gym.
That? Anything new? Anything longer?
Well, I'm going to the Highlands in April with my man. We pitched our tent in the middle of nowhere. It was quite fun. Well, originally, I'm from northern France. I'm from Normandy.
Well, when I came to Shetland to begin with, I was working in Sullenvaux. And, of course, I heard the dialect more or less every day, and decided to come along to a class when it was advertised to become better instructed in the grammar of the dialect.
Over here is Julian.
I'm from Coventry originally, but now I abide in Skelva.
One of my Shetland friends said to me, oh, I don't know what in that, does adopted now, which was a huge compliment.
And what about you, Carl? What news is with you?
No, they're muckle with me. I've been travelling all over Shetland the last two or three days.
Mm-hmm.
And before that, I was travelling all over Scotland for the borders to here.
With my dignity intact, almost, I'm travelling north again, this time to the island of Yell. It's like going back in time as the language here gets closer to its original roots, more Scandinavian and less Scots. This is a wild place with its own kind of rugged beauty, and is home to an accent that's spoken with a rare passion and understanding of its place in history.
What are you doing?
Ewan Henderson crofts on the northern tip of Yell. He's keen to show me the landscape, which for him sums up what it means to come from the islands. So, Ewan, what are we looking at here?
Well, this is one of our proud views here, Carl. This is us over here.
Uh-huh.
And over there is the Saint of Brecon. And that's awful bonny Saint there. Really nice Saint in the summertime, that. See over there?
Yeah.
We've got Muckleflugga Lighthouse, which is the most northerly point in the British Isles.
And where's next? Where's after that?
Well, if you want to go any further than that, you'll have to get in a boat and head out to sea about between 300 and 400 miles, and then you'll get to Norway. This is a splendid place around here for seeing young birds like dunters and tysties and bonksies and Tammy Norries.
What are they? What are Tammy Norries?
Tammy Norries is puffins.
Are they?
Tammy Norries puffins.
What about the other ones? What are they?
Tysties. The tysties pretty seabird.
Aye.
And the bunksies is the, I suppose, the Arctic skua, you would call them, maybe.
Aye.
Bit of a rogue bird.
Aye.
And it's a splendid place for dratsies, too. They'll see two or three dratsies around here.
Would I know a dratsie if I saw one?
Oh, I think they would keen a dratsie. An otter.
An otter, is it?
Yeah, a dratsie.
Yeah.
I'm sure they would keen a dratsie if they saw them.
Yeah. Do you feel Scottish or Shetlandic or maybe even Scandinavian?
I would be considering myself Scandinavian.
Yeah.
Because it really, Shetland belonged to Norway years and years and years ago.
Yeah.
And then it was, of course, gifted over to Scotland. And many, many times I think it was been attempted to be bought back, and I wish it had to be.
Standing here, you, and looking at this, how does it make you feel?
Proud, Carl. I have always been very, very proud of the way I live and how I live, and I always will be. I would never want to do anything else. I've been brought up on a craft all my life. It's been my way of living, and I would like to think it'll be my way of living till the day I go on my box.
Leaving Ewan with his dratsies, I'm impressed by his passion for Shetlandic and by the health of the language. But even here, the pressures of the 21st century are having an influence. So to understand them better and to gain a further insight into the future of Scots, I'm heading south again, back to the urban world where most of us live. Glasgow's seen some dramatic changes, transforming itself from the grime of heavy industry to a modern service-based economy, complete with global brands and shopping malls that could be anywhere. So what's happened to the famous Glasgow accent, for long dismissed as the language of the gutter, home of the famous glottal stope?
I've been up in the barracks for over 20 years. This is Kent Street, but this is about the heart of the barracks, where it comes from. And I know most of the people round about here. Down this street here, there used to be all spielers would be on this street.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, time for the first sale of the day.
Spieling is like your man that shouts with the plates and the pots and the pans and things. All right, James?
Hi, Jimmy.
The plates, pots, pans, curtains, towels, and it generally gives a bit of a show and things like that.
Well, I'll get 5 pence for that.
Money again.
See, stuff like that, eh? That when they go in my ear, somebody can have that for nothing. We'll get 10 pence for that. Eh? This is just a wee clear out here, small change out here. No charge, just get your change out here, and I'm going to get it all sorted for you in a minute.
The secret of a good spieler is obviously is to have good diction and have wit, be funny.
Where do you live? Castlemalt. Hey, Hornell's in your bag, and I hope you drop the thing the way he ain't taking it.
You must have the ability to be able to interest the crowd, to keep an interest in the crowd.
I'm going to try and separate the needy for the greedy, the spires for the buyers, the kidders for the bidders, and I'm going to try and eliminate all the dirty buggers in the house that come out of the bath and dry themselves with the curtains hen, because he cost me a fortune.
I've been here 37 years. Only came in to work for a weekend. The guy was... The last he was off, and he said, "Will you come in for a weekend?" I think you forgot all about me. I'm still here. He's died, but I'm still here. I'm going the same road, by the way. But that people here have been coming here. They have been here. And that was the men. Now I've got their children, and now I've got their grandchildren. And they keep saying, "This is my granddad used to come, my granny used to come." And you can always to them, "I remember your granny and granda." And so you have to tell them that wee bit extra thing that they didn't know about their granny and granda.
The Glaswegian accent is unique.
Huh? Yes, no problem. Any size.
A Glaswegian accent spoke with the proper diction is fantastic. Aye, it's like poetry in motion in the voice, I'd like to think. I love it. Yeah, it's unique. Definitely.
As a Glaswegian, I find it difficult to hear the accent objectively because it's my linguistic home. They tell me it has a hard man image, but I find the accent warm, affectionate and full of humour, which is why it has such a great reputation for comedy.
Six rolls and sausages, mate. A chicken breast stuffed with foie gras wrapped in vine leaves on a bed of couscous.
I don't want any chicken breast stuffed with foie gras wrapped in vine leaves resting on a bed of couscous, mate.
Just use an our own sausage in, mate.
Can you just pull your top up a wee bit there? Thanks very much. It's a lovely cleavage there. I'm just worried if I lean over and talk to you, it'll just echo for 15 minutes.
Comedian Susan Morrison was born and brought up in Glasgow and has her own theories about the accent.
We talk incredibly fast in Glasgow because we all die so quick. So we're hard and we're sharp and we're fast, and that's why it's an excellent view for comedy.
So what's your name, little Dungeon Dragons boy? Ben, hello, Ben. That's a nice, fulsome... You're not Scottish, are you? I didn't think so. You've got all your own teeth and everything. Look,
if you listen to it, there's so many other influences in there, like the Irish and the Highlanders and stuff like that. It's a bit like a Clootie Dumpling.
I'll tell you why we talk so fast in Glasgow. We talk really fast in Glasgow because we die faster than Kennedys, right? We don't have time for vowels and consonants and all that kind of shit. You know, we don't... Grammar, I laugh in your face. We've got to get the talk in before the crematoria comes for us, right? Deep five fags, I'll have that.
It's sharp and it's snappy. It's a language to text in, because it cuts so much out, right? It's an accent to stamp your authority with. It's an accent to pick a fight with. It's an accent to have a good protest with. In fact, I almost think it's an accent for the 21st century. It's a 24/7 accent.
The way we speak in Glasgow can raise the roof, but what about its darker side, its macho, no-mean-city image? If you want to intimidate someone, Glaswegian should be your weapon of choice, but that has less to do with the accent itself and everything to do with class and power. For many years, the Gorbals was associated with the gangs of working-class Glasgow, where hard men claimed the streets of this no-mean city. But what's the reality? Is it an accent to be proud of, or can it only ever be a working-class voice? Tracy Coyle has lived here all her life.
When you meet people, you know, and you tell them where you come from, their whole face changes. And then, but then...
You mean when you say Gorbals?
Yeah, when you say that you come from the Gorbals, you know, people kind of, I think they start to judge you. But I am who I am because I was raised in the Gorbals, and I'm certainly not ashamed of that. But other people, and you sometimes feel, sometimes people have made the comment of, oh, it's nice wee lassie like you. Oh, you come for the Gorbals? And you think, well, what's that all about? Because there's lots of nice people that live in the Gorbals, and I'm certainly not ashamed of that.
So memories of poverty and class prejudice can play a part in modifying an accent. Like other places I've visited, there are two voices in the Gorbals, one for home and one that's more formal.
I've grown up and I've moved out into that big bad world that everybody spoke about when I was a child, and when I was going for a job interview, I couldn't very well go in there and, you know, be asked a question and answer it aye or no. Because, mm-hmm. you know, it's like, a manners thing.
Good manners or not, this can't be right. To be embarrassed by your accent is a feature of a class-ridden society. And someone who was acutely aware of this when he went to Cambridge University is Professor Willie Maley. Like me, Willie was brought up in the schemes of Glasgow's Postle Park.
When I went to Cambridge to do my PhD, and there was bets on in the college that I would lose my accent within 6 months or else leave. But I just carved out my wee ethnic enclave and then my Scottish pals and managed to keep my accent.
Is there a sense in which people's accent changes?
People would talk about their ma having the telephone voice. When the phone went, the ma having said, shut your geggies, would say, yes, it's so-and-so speaking. So I think there is that, and people getting it wrong. But swearing's another thing. People could stick in-die bastard ingestion. I remember one of my sisters saying she had in-die bastard ingestion. So it was amazing. You can just stick a swear word in anywhere, just... hundreds and thousands, just scatter them everywhere.
According to Willie, the way we speak says a lot about our class and where we come from. This intrigues me. Like a lot of Glaswegians, my ancestry is a mixed one, with grandparents from the Highlands and from Eastern Europe. So has immigration had an influence on the Glasgow voice?
I think immigration has just been a fact of life for Glasgow for hundreds of years. I mean, there's always been people coming into the city. My background is Irish immigrant on one side and a grandfather coming down from the Highlands on the other side. So I think there's always been that mix. But I think it's always had a positive effect, and it's always been part of the constantly evolving and changing character of the language.
Glasgow's capacity to absorb different cultures accelerated with the Industrial Revolution. The city attracted thousands of workers from Scotland and beyond. 200 years later, the tradition continues.
At 7.2, this is a Was FM.
City of Glasgow, good afternoon.
The way Scots is used by a local Asian radio station shows how the language continues to embrace the city's new communities.
When I'm talking to anyone, and even if I start talking Punjabi, I still use the word brief because everyone's been bought over, and even it's not translation for words like that.
And from these Dreek streets, I find a warm welcome with Charan Gill, founder of the UK's largest chain of curry restaurants. He came to Glasgow when he was 9 years old, worked as a turner fitter in Yarrow's shipyard, but is now known as the Curry King.
What's your earliest memory of the way that the language sounded to you?
I came from the Punjab straight into Glasgow. So, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I was learning English. This was the Queen's English as I knew it, you know. I didn't know any other language.
Single young man,
Kilted waiters are a feature of Charon's restaurant, and Mark Singh is one of them. I stop him on his way back to the kitchen.
My background basically is my grandfather and my grandmother are from India and Pakistan, and my father is born and brought up in Aberdeen as a youngster, and then he came through to Glasgow and brought up that way. And my mother's from Ireland. She's born and brought up there and came through Edinburgh and stayed there for a bit and such.
So you consider yourself Glaswegian?
I do. Obviously been raised with all the youngsters at the same age group as myself, and all my friends and family are all more or less here. I do say I'm 120% Glaswegian, yeah.
Have you ever thought about changing your accent?
No, I've never changed my accent. Why change? Because, you know, I came here as a young kid. I grew up here, my friends are here, my business is here, my family's here. You know, I'm Glaswegian through and through. I would never change it.
Charngill's affinity with Glaswegian and the city's ability to adapt the language to meet new needs is a sign that Scots is very much alive. As you'd expect, this ever-changing voice has found its way into literature.
I'm special. Special as a ruby slipper. And it's ever since that day, think about it, ever since that day I saved a wee boy at the Gallaudet, that heroic act of bravery, of very braveness. So somebody somewhere said, the boy's a champ, give him a cape. Now I'm starting to ken maybe why I've been different all my life, because I might just have been sent to save mankind. You know, I wanted to write prose that kind of feels like hip-hop. You know, it's sampling for here, it's sampling for there, and it's kind of got that dancey feel to it. You know, novels you can dance to, that's what I'm trying to do, and I think the way I write has got elements of English, elements of the Falkirk dialect that I use, and also the language of popular culture, which the characters are saturated in.
Alan, what do you think of the main influences that are shaping the way Scots speak today?
Well, I think some of it has got to do with the change in jobs over the last 20 years. You know, there are fewer people working in factories, more people working in offices, call centres, which leads to an adaption of the language. But I also think there are certain global influences coming in, particularly American influences, that affect the way especially young people talk. You know, you only have to listen to two 13-year-olds on the bus listen to their speech rhythms, and it's very American. And it's just evolving. It's not necessarily taking the language away. It's just kind of, it's just helping the language adapt, I think, and change over time. And that's a perfectly healthy thing. I don't think that's necessarily a danger.
So you don't see globalisation as a threat?
Well, politically, there's something to be said there, but I think in terms of the language, I think it's the whole idea that we're all going to be speaking one definitive language isn't going to happen, really. You're always going to have regional diversity, and that's an exciting thing.
I've come to the end of what, for me, has been a truly fascinating journey. It's shown me just how rich and diverse Scots can be, but I've also discovered a language under threat. If our language is to survive, two things need to happen. New words have to emerge as we face the challenge of the global village, and we must learn to speak them with confidence and pride. For too long, our voice has been derided, mainly by ourselves, but it's our birthright. It's what defines us, and we must feel at ease with our natural voice. Otherwise, a unique way of expressing our thoughts and feelings, the Scots way, will be lost to future generations. It's up to you.